Well, it looks like Tommy knew how to draw a crowd. As we gather on this day of mourning and celebration, we thank God for the gift of Thomas Piolata in this world and for the many blessings that were given through him that we shared in. At this time, we pray for him on his continued journey to the fullness of God's kingdom, when the Lord will raise his mortal body in death to be joined to his immortal soul in heavenly glory. We also pray for ourselves that the sadness of death gives way to the bright promise of immortality. Let us pray for our husband, our father, our grandfather, our relative, and our friend, Tommy. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Thomas, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. I invite everyone to please be seated and let us listen to the word of God. I invite Philip, his nephew, to please come forward.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. What advantage has the worker from his toil? I have considered the task which God has appointed for men to be busied about. He has made everything appropriate to its time and has put the timeless into their hearts, without men's ever discovering from beginning to end the work which God has done. I recognize that there is nothing better than to be glad and to do well during life. For every man, moreover, to eat and drink and enjoy the fruit of all his labor is a gift of God. I recognize that whatever God does will endure forever. There is no adding to it or taking from it. Thus has God done that he may be revered. What now is has already been. What is to be already is, and God restores what would otherwise be displaced. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. We know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and place us with you in his presence. Everything indeed is for you, so that the grace bestowed in abundance on more and more people may cause the thanksgiving to overflow for the glory of God. Therefore, we are not discouraged. Rather, although our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to what is seen, but to what is unseen. For what is seen is transitory, but what is unseen is eternal. For we know that if our earthly dwelling, a tent, should be destroyed, we have a building from God, a dwelling not made with hands, eternal in heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I have come to believe that you are the Christ, Son of God, the one who is coming into the world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Come, Holy Spirit. Come. If ever any one of us here were to ask the question, what kind of impact on a world can one man have? We must remember this moment. We must remember this church. A church that is full of the living, those who are visible and those who are invisible. This moment, this burial, this mass, this funeral, it is just not right, but it is perfect. Tom, Tommy, Big Tom, Mr. Piolata, our brother, our father, husband, grandpa, fellow Knight of Columbus, parishioner of St. Andrew Church, citizen of Upper Arlington, a Buckeye through and through. The living God has drawn us here at this altar before the Lord Jesus so that we may love, so that we may live in his love. We can so easily get lost in the unfolding of time to the point where we forget, to the point where we are blind to how God in his love is speaking to our hearts and our minds and caressing our lives. How he is seducing our souls. How he works through the brokenness of our humanity and loves the one who is broken. And should the one who is broken be open to his love, God loves everyone through that man. We are here because we have been loved. We are here because we are loved. We are here begging God for the strength and the grace to love in the moments that will follow. In the days leading up to this moment, a week ago Monday, Carla's name appeared on my phone, which is nothing out of the ordinary, if you know how Carla and Tommy related to me and how I related to them. Carla would begin every conversation if it took place on a Monday with, "Now, Father, I know it's your day off. So if I'm annoying you, bothering you, you just tell me, and I will go on." She called. I missed the call. She called again. I called her back. And as we are so wont to do, "Carla, how are you?" And in her voice, God spoke. "Father, we're at the hospital. Tommy died. They brought him back. Can you please get here? Come hell or high water, nothing was going to stop me. Not COVID, not a speed limit, not even the freeway system of Columbus. I found myself with incredible urgency seeking to be there with Carla, Marisa, Maria, Andrea, and Big Tom. Then last night, I found myself sitting in the parking lot at Schrodinger. Everything could have kept me from going in that building, because God's love was just too much. Our brother Paul in the New Testament speaks of the struggle, the war that rages between the body and the spirit. I shared with Adam last night, my flesh has wanted to lash out in anger, but the Lord has whispered an invitation to only be grateful. To be grateful for Tom, to be grateful for his friendship and his love, his fatherhood, his impact on a family, a community, a parish, a whole city, a state. A man who was very broken, but allowed God to heal him. And in his brokenness, he allowed the Lord to love all of us through him. He never claimed to be a saint. He did claim to have power over purgatory, but he never claimed to be a saint. It was a very bizarre claim he had. But therein you find his compassion because of his weakness. There were two groups of humanity whom he was fiercely devoted to, the unborn child and the souls in purgatory. The unborn child is so easily and often forgotten, and the souls in purgatory, no longer visible, oftentimes are also forgotten. He prayed and worked very hard for both, so proud to be a Knight of Columbus, fiercely devoted to the priesthood of Jesus Christ, even more devoted than I dare say some of the priests are. He loved the priesthood. He loved Father Watson, his brother, his friend. He loved Monsignor Maloney. Visiting in their home, he would say, Monsignor loves Mabel. And Carla would yell, don't forget to mention Mabel is a dog, Tommy. Please. Tommy would wink at me, saying, I was just saying that to get a rise out of Carla in the kitchen. He loved St. Andrew's. He loved the Capuchins. He loved the Franciscans. When Carla called to say, Cardinal Sean is coming to the funeral, I thought, oh, thank God, maybe he'll preach. I could hear Brother Tommy in the background, no, 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 he is a Capuchin, he is a Capuchin. He will be with the Capuchins. He is a brother. Big Tom looked at all of the friars as his sons, because his son Tommy entered. After his first real taste of the fraternity, I believe it was at Cap College, he came back and he said, Father, I have so many sons. One of them's even a cardinal. I was like, I know you think highly of your son, but the church has not yet made that declaration just yet. No, not Tommy, I mean Sean O'Malley, he's my son. And I saw him doing dishes. To Marisa and Ryan, Maria and Drew, Andrea and Adam, his daughters. And as Big Tom was wont to remind anyone who dared to listen and had a healthy sense of humor, these are my children. And as Andrea will explain, she is the youngest child, psychologically. And then I have psychologically an only child in Brother Tommy. To Leah, Mira, Nuna, Dominic, Big Dom, Vinny and Daniela, his grandchildren, it never meant how dark the day was in his life. His children and grandchildren were the light placed in his soul by Jesus to help him be strong. Even in those moments where he was overwhelmed with doubt and temptation to fall, even in those moments where he felt that he was looked down upon by people, He could only respond by loving and loving more. He did not have another life, but he did have, I dare to say, a secret lifestyle, and it was loving without drawing attention. When we were allowing ourselves to be guided by the Holy Spirit to consider memories in laughter and then shedding tears in his absence, we were all comparing notes, and we realized, as much as we knew about this man, as much as we loved this man, each one of us knew of something that the others did not know, and it always had to do with how he loved. On one car ride to Steubenville in the worst of the shutdown, when fear engulfed the whole world, literally the whole world, and people were petrified to walk through their front door, let alone leave their city, Tom stopped by to pick me up so we could deliver food to religious houses in the Steubenville area, where the sisters could not purchase enough food because of the rationing. Tom would do food deliveries on my behalf and for their benefit multiple times, oftentimes unbeknownst to many, if not all, who knew him. People thought he was running errands. He was delivering food. We went the first time together. It was a painful car ride because we were both petrified of being pulled over for fear of breaking quarantine. At one point, he said, "Father, if we get pulled over, you lay flat and I'll throw all the vegetables on you." And then he looked at me and said, "You know what, better that I lay flat and you put all the vegetables on me." And I said, "You're the driver. I can't do that." We spoke of the pain in his life and how he was born in the aftermath of the Great War and the wounds of the men and women coming back from the war oftentimes were very much unhealed, and how the wounds they carried inflicted pain on their children. But he said, "I have to learn how to forgive. I have to learn how to forgive." By the time we hit Zanesville, he said, "Father, I've spent the vast majority of my life trying to be successful, have a lot of money, have a big house, nice car. Now I realize the Lord has blessed me with the holy faith and an incredibly beautiful family." He said, "I'm convinced my wife, Carla, is holy, but you're not allowed to tell her that until after I'm gone. Otherwise, there won't be room in the house for me." He said, "What do you think would bring about such a transformation in being empty for so long and now all of a sudden being filled to the brim? I know it's Jesus, but how, where, why, when?" I said, "Tom, we are each on the hill. We are each on the hill. But if we look out at the world, we want what the world offers, but we can never have it. But if we turn around and on that hill take notice of the cross and look up and see Jesus, his love will fill us. We must live the love." That car ride explored everything from God's love to the creation, incarnation, crucifixion, resurrection, ascension, and Pentecost. And he said, "Father, I can't talk about all that with everyone. Just give me one phrase." And I said, "Live the love." And he said, "I can say that. And if anyone asks questions, I'm having them call you. Live the love." He loved Jesus in the Eucharist, attending morning mass. He wanted the words of Paul to be alive so that we have life in the Lord. He was unabashedly faithful to Jesus in the Eucharist, fiercely devoted to the Holy Virgin, and confident in God's divine mercy. In the words between our beloved Savior and his cousin in Bethany, that conversation played over in Big Tom's heart every day. Do you believe? Yes, Lord, I do believe. We stand at the edge of greatness, even though it's just not right. It is perfect. God's love is here. This church is full. If you visited his home, you would notice the heart of Jesus by the door and the heart of Mary just above. He lived in the heart of the Lord, and he wanted all of his children and grandchildren, his family and friends, to do the same. He wanted everyone to live the love. We have been shaped by the Old Testament, formed by the words of the New Testament, and given life by the Holy Gospel. But we don't gather here to celebrate a dead man's life. We pray here together with gratitude to God for the gift of life, which is eternal. The life that knows no end for the one who believes in Jesus. No matter where you may be in your faith or in your heart or in your soul, you are here because you knew, you know, you love a man who was transformed by God's grace. He received the anointing of the sick and the apostolic pardon. He has a mass being offered for him, rosaries being prayed, love being shed, offered and given. In this holy mass, we pray for him, and we dare to ask for God's mercy upon his soul. But you see, if you pray this mass and you believe, and you are a witness to the resurrection, you have great confidence and hope. You know that your refuge is the heart of Jesus. And learning from our beloved Tom, hearing the words of the gospel, our brother St. Paul, and the wisdom from the Old Testament, we each know if we want to live, we must live in the love.
Please stand. I invite Jennifer Miller to come forward to assist with our petitions. God the Almighty Father raised Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask him to save all his people, living and dead.
For Tommy, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
for the end of abortion, and for the healing of all men and women who have been wounded by it, that the sanctity of life may be reduced, may be revealed, and embraced by all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of our brother Tommy, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. And I invite the grandchildren who are bringing forth the gifts to please go back to the back. I invite everyone to please stand. Our gifts have been prepared. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings for the salvation of your servant, Tommy, O Lord, we beseech your mercy, so that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him also a merciful judge, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended, and when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with all the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Everyone to please kneel or be seated. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts that we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope and Robert our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant, Tommy, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. When from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you are God as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Please stand. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. I invite everyone to please kneel or be seated. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, that our brother Tommy may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I invite his brother-in-law, Tom Gill, to please come forward.
I love him. I've been totally amazed over the last 10 days of the number of people that he has touched. It's unprecedented in my lifetime. And I was sitting with Carla this morning, and she said to me, God touches others through the simple and the humble. My God, that is exactly what Tommy is. And then I was with my nephew, Tommy, and he called him perfectly imperfect. That's what Tommy Piolata was, perfectly imperfect. Carla, I want to thank you for asking me to speak. It's been a joy collecting my thoughts about Tommy, and I just feel really honored. I've known Tommy for 45 years. I dated and married his sister, Michelle. He's been my brother-in-law, my friend, mentor, and most of all, my brother. He had many gifts and talents. The first thing I was introduced to was his crazy, joyful sense of humor. He held on to it and shared it his entire life. Family gatherings were always filled with laughter and joy. People continually comment on his ability to make them smile and laugh. I heard that more in the last 10 days. And in the families grieving the past several days, we would cry together and then quickly turn to laughter as a Tommy story was told. And there were times where I was laughing so hard I couldn't breathe. Those memories were just so great. It was a gift. Joyfulness was one of his many qualities. Tommy was an artist, witnessed by his love of painting. He was a drummer, playing with several bands throughout his years. The most memorable for me was Phil Dirt and the Dozers at Maria's wedding. He loved music and enjoyed orchestrating his three daughters to sing Shaboom Shaboom. He was an author who wrote a book about his grandchildren, Five Frogs on Biscuit Bay. Luna, the sixth grandchild, was newly born and became the moon. He talked to me about his desire to write a second book, and it was always about his family, about his life, and about his experiences. Tommy was an inventor, creating, patenting, and bringing to market the family toy Zeringo. I never could play it. I never could get those rings to go like they should. But the rest of the family showed me up with that. He was a black belt, golfer, sports fan, and competitor. He ended every prayer with, "Go Bucks." If you want love, be love, invited in by offering it to others. Tommy was a teacher and a mentor to me. I wish I could be the giver of life that he was. I truly admire that. He had great compassion for others. I can't tell how many times in the last 10 days I heard people say that Tommy supported them and encouraged them when they needed it. And they would say, without Tommy, I'm not sure what my life would be like. That is so true as I look back on mine. People loved being with him. He gave himself unselfishly to organizations like Knights of Columbus and the Catholic Church. He loved them so much. He served in any way he could with joy, and I never heard him once complain about having to serve, never one time. His commitment was admirable. He was a lover of people, and it was evident with everyone he came in contact with. He learned how to forgive. He learned how to encourage. He was fantastic, the best I've seen at ignoring the craziness and the busyness of life just to take a moment to care and nurture. Tommy had great courage and wisdom that others would seek him out for. All this was most evident when observing his family. He supported his grandchildren, Dominic, Leah, Vinnie, Lala, Mira, Luna, and all their concerns and endeavors. He always cheered them on daily. He showed great compassion and love towards Carla's family, the Chatelas, Kim and Tina, Frank and Carrie, Italia, who loved all of you. All of his nieces and nephews weren't nieces and nephews, they were like his own. And he treated them that way. Ryan, Adam, and Drew were his sons, not his son-in-laws. I was his brother. I'm going to miss him. I loved him. He was very proud of Marisa, Maria, and Andrea. He loved the women that they have grown to be. He loved how they cared for their families and how responsible they've been to their work and to their life. He enjoyed watching them succeed and overcoming their challenges in life. He loved playing with them, especially when it got competitive. He was also very proud of Tommy. He fully supported him in his decision and commitment to become a Capuchin in the Franciscan Order of the Catholic Church. He greatly missed Tommy. He spoke to him several times a week and has truly loved the man that Tommy is becoming while he's studying in Rome. It has been my pleasure watching him with his children and how they've responded with such intimacy, calling him Daddy. Daddy comes from the heart. He wasn't a father. He wasn't dad. He was Daddy. That intimacy was awesome to see. He had great concern, love, and admiration for his sister, Michelle. They would talk with one another often, and he would ask her advice and in turn share his wisdom with her. He would pour out his heart and feelings to her and often sought support and encouragement. They were great at laughing with each other, crying with each other, and just sharing life. His wife Carla was his rock. She was his most trusting ally. In her quiet, controlling way, she would provide guidance, support, love, and nurturing to Tommy. I was truly amazed when I heard conversations about concerns they had, how they were able to work through them, how open they were with each other, seemingly without fear. That's hard for me to do sometimes in my marriage. Tommy always owned his shortcomings. He never avoided them. He wasn't proud of them, but he talked about them. And he was constantly working towards becoming the man he wanted to be. God was truly the foundation of this marriage. I witnessed it every day. Tommy's family is the most close, loving, giving, caring family towards each other I've ever experienced. Despite the struggles, hurts, and challenges of life, Tommy always had time for his family and their challenges. He was always the support, the encouragement, the wisdom, and the glue that held this family together. He was the inspiration. He was the true leader. Tommy never would have accepted that compliment. This was a way of life for him. He wasn't aware of the impact he had on people. He just did it. He had a hidden presence. He was a support and guide in times of trouble. Humility was truly a gift of his. He truly lived to love. At Easter, he gave me a book, The Consecration of Saint Joseph. He told me that this book had more impact on his life than any single book he has ever read other than the Bible. Saint Joseph inspired him. Saint Joseph was a spouse of the Blessed Virgin Mary. He was the earthly father and had the responsibility of raising, teaching, and protecting Jesus. It's just unbelievable to me. He had complete faith and trust in God. This is what Tommy wanted and aspired to be. He loved God. He trusted God. Tommy Piolata is a child of God. Tommy, we love you, and we're celebrating with you. And we want to see you in the kingdom. Please continue to guide us, inspire us, encourage us, and protect us. For you have become like Saint Joseph. Extremely blessed. Thank you.
God is good. God is good.
All the time.
Amen. On behalf of my mom, in a special way, Cardinal, thank you so very much for coming here from Boston in the midst of a very busy season. Thank you for the humility that you've helped show your fellow Capuchins and that my parents and my family have witnessed. And from the bottom of my heart, I want to share my Capuchin brothers for being here. Thank you. Thank you. So I'm 16 years old and I get a traffic ticket. I have to go to traffic court. And I'm about to go and I have a sweatshirt on and my mom says, Tommy, you can't wear a sweatshirt to traffic court. Like you can't wear a sweatshirt in front of a judge. You know, go put on your shirt and tie. So I did, and I go to traffic court with my dad. And near the end of the proceeding, the trial, the judge turns to my dad and goes, Mr. Piolata, is there anything you would like to say on behalf of your son? Well, Your Honor, if I must say something, the boy is insane. You're all laughing, but when it happened, no one laughed. And my mom was concerned about my sweatshirt. Thanks, Dad. Stories abound of this man, of my hero and my best friend. There are so many stories. And I don't just want to share stories with you. I want to tell you why there are so many stories. There are so many stories because this heart of this man was completely full of life. I cannot help but think of Jesus in the Gospel of John when he says, I have come so that my sheep might have life and have it abundantly. That man was abundant in his life. I can't help but think when Jesus said, I have come so that their joy might be complete. This man was a giver, is a giver of joy. And if I can try to share why there are so many stories, it's because this man is a man of family, he is a man of faith, and he is a man of intense love. In the midst of a broken world, in the midst of human limitations, in the midst of so many faults, so much suffering, trials and tribulations, this man is a man of family, faith, and love. My Uncle Tom spoke beautifully about how much he loved his family, and if I can just add one thing, Philip, you said something yesterday. You said, when he walked in the room, my heart lit up. Think of St. Francis, and there's a beautiful letter he wrote. And he said, hold back nothing of yourself for yourself. Dad, you did not hold back anything of yourself for yourself. As a father, husband, brother, grandfather. My dad was a man of faith. Let me read you a text he wrote me one morning before I had a meeting. Good morning. I'm up early, as you can tell. I'm about to say a rosary for you, and I already talked to St. Joseph, St. Solanus Casey, St. Pio, and St. John Paul. They are all in your corner. I have asked the Blessed Mother through my rosary to be next to you during your meeting. May God bless you today and keep you strong. Have no fear. God's will provide you with strength. Only a man of faith can write that. And he would tell me often that our faith is not a myth. It's not something just for the imagination. It's real. It's true. It is what gives us life. A Capuchin brother of mine from Australia wrote me a letter. He spent 3 days with my dad. and he said, "My father's life is a testimony to the power of faith." He had faith that God so loved the world that he sent his only son. He had faith that his son died for us because he loved us intensely and infinitely. And he had faith that eternal and powerful and omnipotent and infinite love raised this man on the cross who we celebrate as crucified and risen, and in whom we find every answer to our life. That is the content of my father's faith. Hold back nothing of yourself for yourself. Dad, in your faith, you held back nothing for yourself. My father was a man of love. I can't tell you how many people yesterday said he was my best friend. Not friend, not great friend, not close friend, best friend. I was driving in winter one day with my father. It was cold and snowy, and he saw someone walking on the side of the street. He turned around the car, pulled up next to him, and said, "You're going to freeze out here. Can I take you somewhere?" The man got in the car, and my dad drove him to work. That's one example. Someone told me yesterday he made me feel wildly important. He loved strangers, friends, saints, family, Almighty God. I kid you not, I think he has given the phone before to someone he just met when I called him. "Oh, Tom, here's so-and-so. Say hi to him." Beloved, let us love one another because love is of God, says John in his first letter. Oh, Dad, we have so much to learn from you. I wasn't able to make it home in time to see my dad before he breathed his last. And so when I got to the airport, I said, "I'm not reading anything, I'm not listening to any music, I'm not having wine with lunch, I'm not watching any movies, I wanted to suffer. I'm so sorry I wasn't there." And so when I got to the airport, I said, I'm praying and I'm writing a letter to my father for the next 15 hours of my life. I read this letter to my mom and she said, "You need to read that. It's painfully vulnerable. But if I can just show you the beauty of this man, I have to read it." "Daddy, I'm coming home. I'm coming home to see you and to be with you. It looks like the Father is preparing you for your own homecoming. How I pray to be there for it. To be honest, though, I don't want you to go. I want to spend more time with you. But you always said you're in my heart, and you'll always be with me. You're a part of my life. Truly, I text you, and we talk on the phone all the time. We talk about really deep things, and we make up other personalities and literally have a fake phone conversation. We talk about everything, and you always tell me how much you love me and how proud you are of me. I want to give your name the greatest honor because you deserve it. I hope, too, that I can be the giver of joy like you. You gave a lot of joy to the world, and in this you manifested the closeness of God incarnate. You are special to the Lord, of this I am sure. And notwithstanding many trials and tribulations and shortcomings, you never let go. And you always loved me. I've never been found wanting of a father's love. And if I can just say, I don't think many people can say that. How am I to thank God sufficiently for you? I'm coming home, Daddy. Please just hold on a little longer. Hey, Dad, I'm on the plane. I'm coming home. I met a sister from the United States, and she said she'll pray a rosary that I make it to you in time. You were and are an amazing father. You have a lot of love, a beautiful heart. I think you are one of God's special creatures, a particularly crafted flower with a particular mission. You gave joy and you gave the world the most beautiful family. I think the devil tried your whole life to pull you away from that. But he can't even make a banana. You're special to God, to our Father. And I know I can't be selfish, but I don't want you to leave yet, Dad. I'm not ready. I want more time with you. I want you to see what I do in the future. I love making you proud. If the Father is calling you home, please come visit me. I'm going to be alone without you. Maybe I can just keep writing you letters, and I will storm heaven asking the Father to send you to appear to me. I already miss you. Thank you, Daddy, for everything, for loving me unconditionally, for never judging us, for always supporting us and encouraging us. You make me feel unstoppable, like a champ. Thanks for watching fireworks with me as a kid, taking me on bike rides, bringing me to Taekwondo and supporting me every step of the way, for getting me into drums. By the way, I talked to Zach last night, and he said he doesn't think he'd be where he is without you. You were probably our number one fan. You've always been that to all of us. Thank you for teaching me to shake hands with a firm grip and to always look in the eyes. Thank you for teaching me to say sir and ma'am and always offer help to the elderly. Thank you for inspiring me by your prophetic love for children and for those growing inside the womb. You saw reality in this so clearly. You saw beautiful gifts of God. Thank you. Thank you for supporting me when I became a friar. And thank you for praying the Litany of St. Joseph with me during Lent. Every day we prayed it together. Thank you for teaching me to pray the rosary when I can't fall asleep and to hold the rosary when I'm afraid. I was having trouble sleeping one time, and he said, well, Tom, are you sleeping with your rosary? And I said, no, Dad, I always lose it. Tom, you gotta sleep with your rosary. Thank you for being a lover of our Blessed Mother. Thank you for loving my mother, your wife, until the end. Even in the deep and painful lows, you both honored your vows. Mom, thank you. You guys did it. Thank you for loving my sisters, your daughters. I will always cherish those many moments on the phone when you would talk about those four amazing, beautiful people sitting right here. And he would simply praise each one of you. He could not talk about one within adding on something about each and every one of you. And if I can say, if you want to see what this man looked like in the depth of his love, look at his wife and his three beautiful daughters. Thank you for your faith in the Lord, commitment to the church, for your devotions. Thank you for your innocent belief in miracles and love for the saints. I have to admit that I'm kind of a skeptic sometimes when I hear miracle stories, but my dad had a childlike faith, and he would share with me something, and sometimes I wouldn't respond. He said, Tom, why aren't you responding? What do you think, Tom? I took a little break. I may have even slept. I prayed mostly. St. Joseph is with you, Dad. I was thinking earlier, and I never really stopped playing with you. Ever since I was a child, I loved playing with you, whether it was kicking your ass at Madden football or in basketball or play fighting. I think Mom kicked us out of the house one time. In Squire's Lane, we broke something in the closet, and she said, both of you, get out. I've always enjoyed life with you. You add salt to life, Dad. I remember when I was much younger, I'd be so excited to go to work with you. I'm thinking of your office way back in the day at Sawmill. I'm pretty sure no one else brought their kids as often as you brought me. My dad is so special. My memories are all over. I'd love to capture every moment and relive it. Dad, I'm not ready for you to leave yet. I want to talk to you more on the phone and play more golf and go on and eat and road trips, stay in hotels, and you know, maybe even play some blackjack. Daddy, I'm not going to lie. I think this has been one of, if not the most painful challenges of my life. I offer all of my pain and the pain of not being able to be there in Thanksgiving. And that St. Joseph may hold you in your transitus. St. Joseph and John Paul II, St. Francis, Padre Pio, Solanus Casey, St. Lucy and Our Lady, and all of the angels, now you'll be able to help them put circles around our houses. When I was a boy, my father would pray with me before going to bed. And the last thing we would do is ask the angels to put a circle around our house. And then we would go through everyone. And now he can do that. I want more time with you here. You're a part of me, Dad. I love you. Your son loves you so much. I'm almost to Dallas, Dad. And there, and then just one more flight. Then I get to be with you. Thank you for all of your affection, for teaching me about the power of human contact. I used to always like shaking your hand at the airport and then giving you a great hug. There's something special about a father and a son shaking a hand. And we would always do that, but then we would always give each other a big hug. You gave me love and joy, affection and laughter. I will continue the tradition. I'll keep the beauty of our name. I've been praying a lot. Sometimes I can't do much more than just hold the rosary. I didn't watch any movies or listen to music, didn't even read. I didn't want anything to get in the way of you and this experience. Prayer was the only option. If our Father is getting ready to call you home, be not afraid, Dad. You can't imagine all the masses said for you, all of the prayers. You'll be on your way home to glory. I'm almost home, Daddy. Just hold on a little longer. Dad, I didn't make it to you in time. I'm about to depart on a plane in Dallas for Columbus. I can't believe I wasn't there. Dad, I'm going to miss you unbelievably every day. Please appear to me. I'm having trouble processing right now. You're not supposed to die. I need my faja. I want you longer, Daddy. Part of me wants to say I don't have a dad anymore, but that's not true. You always told me you'll always be with me. And you always told us to remember where we come from. I just want more time with you. I'm not ready for this. Daddy, I love you so much. I will be with you again. I was just thinking about how I always text you often and after and while I'm playing golf or during my My dear Dad, I think I'm in shock. I don't know what to write, but I want to write because I want to talk to you. I loved as a boy laying with you on the couch watching TV and movies, and it was so easy to get you to take me to the computer store to buy computer games. Thank you for reading books with me. I remember, of course, Martin Luther King Jr.'s biography and for praying with me. You have always showered me with love. The captain said 49 minutes. I'm coming home, Daddy. I'm so sorry it wasn't sooner. Thank you for fighting for me. You had your girls with you and your grandchildren. I'm coming. I'll take care of Mommy and your daughters, but they are all our heroes. Dad, you're my hero. I want to be like you as I continue this fragile journey forward to our true homeland. God willing, I can be a giver of joy like you, my hero, my best friend, my dad. You have blessed me continuously for 30 years. Now I will honor you. I love you, Dad, always. Dad, you left the greatest and richest inheritance that a son could ask for, that daughters could ask for, that your wife could ask for, that your whole family could ask for. You left an inheritance of family, of faith, and of love. And we will continue this tradition and carry it forward. Praised be Jesus Christ.
I invite Brother Bob Marva of the Capuchins to please come forward.
Thank you, Father. I'm Brother Bob Marva. I serve as the Vicar Provincial for the Capuchin Franciscans in the province of St. Augustine. On behalf of our provincial Brother Tom Betts, the brothers gathered here, and the brothers throughout the world, to all who are gathered, our condolences and our prayers for you. A special way to you, Mom, our mom, Carla, our brother, Tommy, and to your sisters, we, your brothers, please know we share your gratitude for your husband and for your father, our father. We share your faith that he is at peace. We share your hope that we will see him again. And please know that friars throughout the world, in Papua New Guinea, in Puerto Rico, in Rome, and everywhere the friars gather to pray this day, we are remembering you and praying for our dad, Tommy. There is a hymn that we Capuchins sing to the Blessed Mother in times of great joy and in times of sorrow. We sing this hymn now, as Tommy had such a great devotion to the Blessed Mother through her rosary. May she now intercede on his behalf as we commend him to the Lord.
Besides the Capuchin brothers, deacons, priests, and cardinal who have come here to grace us today, I would also like to recognize the priests of the Diocese of Columbus who are here to celebrate as well, our pastor here at St. Andrew's, Monsignor Stephen Maloney, Father Jonathan Wilson, pastor of Westerville, and also, of course, Father Stash Daly, who delivered the homily today, and Father Bill DeVille, who has been a fixture in these parts for, well, since Tommy was in high school. And he tried to keep him in line. I'm not so sure how that came about, whether it was positive or negative, but I've had the pleasure of knowing Tommy since freshman in high school at Waterson. And I think Michelle could attest to this, that there were a crazy cast of characters that were part of the class of 69. And later on, Carla would often refer to the year that we were born in 1951, saying that that year there was too much rain, meaning that somehow we didn't quite come out quite right. But, you know, no one would have ever thunk back then that someone who was rather impetuous, impish, and yet a lovable child of God would have the kind of fanfare about leaving this world today. That would have been beyond anyone's imagination. But it kind of confirms that God writes straight with crooked lines. And referring to Tom Gill and Brother Tommy's statement about life, about being created perfectly imperfect in the image and likeness of God. And for one to come to acknowledge and be comfortable with that in their skin, and to love oneself despite oneself and their faults and limitations and behavior, etc., is a great gift. Tommy loved who he was as he was, being who he was, and being able to live out of that was a great gift to us. But secondly, he loved God and the Blessed Mother more. And that really, those two combinations, he gave us a legacy of living in faith, in living in family, and living amongst friends. Amongst us today, there is part of that cast of characters of the class of 69, and friends from the SIF, and friends all around that come to know and to enjoy Tommy being who he was as he was. May we continue to live our lives in that same type of spirit, in the fullness of humanity and divinity.